Hey, Tom, how are you?
I'm good.
So,
close those doors.
Tom Harris? Nice to meet you. Seriously. I'm Chris. We do? Yeah. Water and climate.
Okay, let's get started. Good day, everyone. Welcome to the Council on Foreign Relations and this roundtable on water and U.S. national security. Some of you know me. For those who don't, I'm Paul Stairs. I'm a senior fellow here in conflict prevention as well as director of its Center for Preventive Action. I think it's fair to say we've been waiting a long time for this day to arrive. I think it was over a year ago when our colleagues in the Center for Geoeconomic Studies approached Josh to write this paper for us on water and U.S. national security. And I think it's also fair to say that this issue has been more complex and convoluted than we expected. And certainly I've grown to a greater appreciation of how important this issue is. I think I was among some of the skeptics about what the nexus really was about and whether it was as important as people said. But I've come away from working on this project with Josh with a much keener appreciation of not just its complexity, but also how consequential it will be in the coming years and could be. So we're very pleased to have Josh here present the findings and recommendations of his study, and I think you should all have it in front of you. He will talk for about, I think, 10, 15 minutes, and then we will open up. I should say I want to leave as much time as possible for presentations, discussions, so I'm going to dispense with lengthy bio, but we have it in the packet here. He is associate professor at the Lyndon Baines Johnson School of Public Affairs at the University of Texas in Austin. Came up last night, right? And longtime observer, researcher in the area of environmental security or the environment and national security, written widely on this issue. We're also pleased to have David Michel here. He is a nonresident fellow at the Stimson Center, also a longtime participant, observer, specialist, researcher in this area, and we're very pleased to have him join us. He, I believe, is going to comment somewhat on Josh's, but also make his presentation of his own. Both have, I should say, presentations, which I hope you can all see up on the screen. You should be able to. So once the presentations are over, we will open it up for Q&A. Hopefully we'll have a good time for that. Just let me reiterate the discussion is on the record here, just in case that any of you may be under the assumption that it's not for attribution. Also, if you have any cell phones, electronic devices, please, at the very least, turn it to mute, if not better still, actually fully off. And so I think that is it. So Josh, why don't you take it away first, and then we'll hand it over to David afterwards. Thank you again, and thank you all. Really appreciate you being here today.
I'd like to thank the council for hosting me today and providing me with this platform to write about this important issue. Special thanks to Paul and Lindsay Iverson, who shepherded the project over the finish line. I'd also like to thank Michael Levy, who initiated the process to have me write this paper for the council. And I'd also like to thank those who participated in the review process, some of whom are in the room today. The comments and conversations I had with all of you made the paper stronger. And in addition, I benefited from a number of conversations with experts in the water space whose ideas helped shape my thinking on this topic. You all have my biography before you, but I wanted to mention that I've been writing on climate and national security since the mid-2000s, including a 2007 piece for the council, and I've written for Brookings and academic publications like International Security, Political Geography, among others, and I've been on two Minerva Initiative research grants from the Department of Defense, the CCAPS Initiative on Climate Change and African Political Stability, and I'm the principal investigator of one ongoing on South and Southeast Asia called SEPSA. By way of introduction, I wanted to give you an example, start talking about this issue, talk about the Indus River Basin, which stretches from the Tibetan Plateau and extends through India and Pakistan, emptying into the Arabian Sea. Along the way, it supplies water to as many as 215 million people directly and indirectly, and it's the lifeblood of cities, agricultural regions, power stations, and factories. And because water is essential to life but unequally distributed, it's a source of contestation and cooperation. Transboundary agreements on water have largely contained and moderated many of the conflicts in the past, but whether that remains true in the future is uncertain, especially as you have increased demands for water and climate change makes water scarcity and volatility more acute. Now, you might have seen stories last September and October about India threatening to pull out of the Indus Water Treaty with Pakistan in retaliation for attacks on Indian soldiers in the disputed region of Kashmir. And now that treaty has survived not only hot conflicts between the countries on other issues, it's also served to moderate tensions between them since it came into force in 1960. Indus provides 90% of Pakistan's water for agriculture, and that sector employs as much as 50% of the Pakistani workforce. And it's increasingly important to the country, as you see on the right, as experts say that Pakistan's water scarcity problem has become more severe. And with India also trying to develop upstream water resources, relations over water have become more contentious and added the mix of other sorts of contentious issues between the two countries. So this is an example, of course, but both of these countries are strategically important to the United States for different reasons, and having two nuclear weapon states at risk of conflict is undesirable. But water is also a cause for domestic political crises. And again, staying with the Indus example for the moment, it's the size of seasonal flooding. So in 2010, nearly 20 million people were at risk and affected by massive flooding. Nearly 2,000 people died. And the president of Pakistan was subject to considerable domestic criticism for failure to mount a credible and adequate response. The United States government, as it often does, was called in to supply humanitarian relief and emergency response. Turning to a separate issue, a separate region of the world, water can also play a strategic role in conflict. You may have seen reports that ISIS temporarily seized Iraq's Mosul Dam in 2014 until coalition forces dislodged them, potentially threatening downstream access by important population centers. So the ability to withhold water or potentially inundate neighboring areas elevates the significance of dams and reservoirs. And related to that, as we've seen this week in California with the Oroville Dam, aging infrastructure can pose risks of collapse that put at risk neighboring cities. And the same Mosul Dam, American military engineers have warned its frailty could potentially, if it collapsed, lead to effects on is of up to 1.5 million people. So these kinds of examples, water and security concerns, affect every region of the world, from nearby in the Americas to Africa to current sites of strategic concern in the Middle East and Central Asia to South and Southeast Asia. Some countries like Yemen face chronic water scarcity year-round. Hundreds of millions in China and Africa face significant water scarcity for at least some months of the year. And these problems are likely to get worse in a number of places as increased demands for urbanization, industrialization lead to more diverse demands for water. And indeed, with climate change, many regions will face not just water scarcity, but volatile rains with long periods of drought punctuated by heavy rains that can lead to flooding. And crucially, many regions of the world lack adequate institutions to manage these water challenges, both within and between countries. And so without adequate water management, some regions of the world, according to the World Bank, could face GDP losses as much as 6% by 2050. The 2012 National Intelligence Council report on water and security concluded from this kind of body of evidence that during the next 10 years, many countries important to the United States will experience water problems, shortages, poor water quality, or floods that will risk instability and state failure, increasing regional tensions, and distract them from working with the United States on important U.S. policy objectives. And we can talk later in the Q&A about which kinds of places that they're most concerned about. The U.S., United States government has some of the best resources in the world to understand global water challenges, including satellite monitoring, remote sensing, and programs like FuseNet, the Famine Early Warning Systems Network. And the State Department has a special coordinator for water resources with a small staff who is here today, delighted to have Aaron Salzberg here with us today. And now he convenes an interagency water working group. But, you know, from the conversations that I've had with a variety of folks, one of the challenges that the United States government faces is that we don't have sustained high-level attention to this issue, and we don't have this issue being made a priority at the level of the White House or at cabinet level on a continuous and sustained basis. And that makes it difficult to get buy-in from all the relevant agencies to support work in this space. And where we do have water resources for water, it appears to be mostly in the form of money for taps and toilets, and that's a really important agenda. To be sure, and Congress has supported the water and sanitation agenda through the 2005 Paul Simon Water for the Poor Act and then the 2014 Water for the World Act. Between 2007 and 2016, the State Department and USAID have spent more than $6 billion on this agenda in more than 50 countries. But the agenda is a little narrow and hasn't been much money in the way of supporting water management institutions, which is really critical. And beyond that, the United States government has not taken full advantage of the myriad resources in the private sector, universities, and NGOs, who all have resources, expertise, and interest in the water space. Now, to be sure, the U.S. has supported the U.S. Water Partnership, and that's an important beginning, but I don't think we've realized our full potential in this space. So that leads me to the following four recommendations. Enhance the priority of water and security in the U.S. government. Support data collection, analysis, and early warning systems, invest in institutions, and support public-private partnerships. Let me say a bit more about each one of these. Now, there was some impetus for addressing water and security issues when then-Secretary of State Clinton requested the 2012 NIC report on water and security, and I think those concerns somewhat dissipated when John Kerry became Secretary of State. His priorities lay elsewhere. Now, ideally, this issue would receive high-level attention from the White House through something like a national security decision directive. And the Water for the World Act mandates the government perform a global water strategy by October of this year. So this effort and the focus on water and security could get a boost if the White House were to request that this strategy have a strong emphasis on world water security and reflect on the risks, the investment opportunities, and the possible hotspots. And as I wrote in this paper, water and security will ultimately get the attention it deserves if it's backed not only by high-level attention from the president, but also resources. And I suggested on the order of $100 million would be large enough to drive interagency interest in this portfolio. Now, in terms of data collection, the United States government already has some of the finest capabilities in this space, and it should retain and enhance support for federal government capabilities from NASA and other agencies. And I was distressed to hear that some of the incoming administration's transition officials have mooted that instead of an emphasis on Earth systems monitoring, that NASA would only work on space exploration. And for me, that would be a real problem. That would be penny wise, but a pound foolish. It would degrade our government's situational awareness of weather-related phenomena and just be a step in the wrong direction. Now, Let me say a bit about expenditures, if anything, should be increased in this space, not just by federal government agencies, but also researchers in the private sector and universities. So in the context of writing this this paper, I came across really important resources that the U.S. government has supported in the past, including research from Oregon State and its Transboundary Freshwater Dispute Database, as well as the work of iSciences. Tom Paris is here with us today, which carries out seasonal forecasts of emergent water scarcity. Both have received intermittent support from the U.S. government in the past, and I recommend that sustained support for initiatives like these would that could deliver periodic updates on basins at risk or emergent hotspots facing acute water shortages would be really beneficial. Now, two final points that I wanted to make. One of the most important observations from research on trouble spots is many of them suffer from absent or inadequate institutions to monitor water problems, to share data, to convene stakeholders, and mediate and resolve disputes. And a number of basins like the Mekong, for example, they have institutions, but they don't include important stakeholders, like in that case, China, or they've declined in capacity in recent years. And when you think about the same problem inside countries, country management of water inside country borders suffers, it's often haphazard, suffers from challenges of valuing water property, systems subsidize some users who could probably pay for it, and others users lack access entirely. A great percentage of water is wasted through leaky pipes or other kinds of outdated agricultural systems. So while conflicts related to water aren't inevitable, certainly hot conflicts, violent conflicts, they're going to become more frequent and severe if there is inadequate investment in institution building, both to manage transboundary water issues as well as water issues within countries. So finally, we have to realize that the capacity of governments are limited, including our own. And they're corporations, universities, and civil society organizations with expertise and interest in this space. Many of them are in the room today. And so in the paper, I talk about three different kinds of public-private partnerships, supply partnerships to boost supplies of water through technology like desalination, water management partnerships to encourage efficient use of water, conservation, drip irrigation, pricing systems that value water property but protect and extend access for those most vulnerable. And then finally, partnerships to waterproof infrastructure from the adverse effects of storm surges, floods, and other phenomena. So this would include efforts like conservation easements and protection of mangroves to protect natural drainage systems and reduce risk in the vicinity of urban areas. So I think more available resources from the US government to crowd in, not crowd out, but to crowd in private sector resources would help expand the good work of the US Water Partnership. And last point I wanted to make, and then I'll stop, is we need to have an ethos of doing no harm. The Americans have a can-do mentality, which I think has served us well, but efforts to address water insecurity challenges have a history. Where it's not just tabula rasa, blank slate. Some of it supported by the U.S. government and other actors. And as we've seen with difficult water work of the provincial reconstruction teams in Afghanistan and Iraq, it's not always successful. And moreover, U.S. efforts won't always be welcome in some contexts, and some of those situations may not be ripe for U.S. interventions or by other partners. So even as we boost the profile of water insecurity, as I think we should, we have to be cognizant of the need to incorporate this ethos, a sort of Hippocratic oath of sorts, into our foreign policy. And with that, I'll stop and turn it over to David. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Josh. I thank Josh for this paper and this opportunity to take part in this roundtable. Also, Paul and Council on Foreign Relations for inviting me here, and of course, all of you for being here. Great. I like images, so I've put together a PowerPoint as well. And I'd like to begin by just taking a step back from Josh's paper and the underlying premises and issues about the relationship between water governance, water security, and U.S. national security. So the United Nations, which button did I press?
Press the right one. That's the little arrow.
Okay, there we go. Wrong right hand, but the United Nations defines water security as the capacity of a population to safeguard sustainable access to adequate quantities of acceptable quality water for sustaining livelihoods, human well-being, and socioeconomic development, for ensuring protection against waterborne pollution and water-related disasters, and for preserving ecosystems in a climate of peace and political stability. So what does this entail then? for managing water resources, for water governance as a whole. When we're talking about managing water to ensure water security, we're talking about issues of sanitation and public health, development, agriculture, food production, energy generation, water pollution, water quality, ecosystem services, managing weather extremes and water-related disasters, flooding and droughts. And all of these issues are interrelated, both in the management of those water resources. There may be trade-offs in between different policy objectives. Think of the case right now of the Oroville Dam in California, which is they released water from that dam as it was the water level was rising. One of the reasons, because they were anticipating storms in the following days. And if you're managing a dam for water storage so that you can have that water available for irrigation or for running through turbines to generate power, there's a trade-off between that objective, keeping dam levels high so you have that stored water, versus flood protection and flood control, where you want the water levels to be lower so you can accommodate incoming floodwaters. There may be trade-offs then in between water for irrigation, water for energy generation, water for flood protection, but there are also connections between these issues, not only sectorally, but geographically and through the global hydrological cycle, that rivers, aquifers, transcend borders and boundaries. There are 276 transboundary river basins in the world, almost 400 transboundary aquifers, the same patchwork of transboundary waters occur also at the domestic level, transboundary at the level of states and communities, not only internationally. And through, as I was saying, the hydrological cycle, these issues are connected through not only shared surface waters, shared aquifers, but through issues such as climate change, to which all of us are contributing. Our emissions here in the United States or emissions in China affecting global weather patterns with then repercussions on the management of these issues of energy production, food production. And additionally, those questions are also connected globally through global markets. There is a global market for food grains. There is a global market for natural gas, for oil. So think of an energy manager making a decision about a new power source, a new generation source for a community, for a country. Will I build a dam for hydropower? Will I build a natural gas power plant? That choice of fuels, if you will, depends on global forces and global markets. So these issues are interconnected. What are the stakes of managing these resources for water security? Well, the annual cost of environmental degradation of water, the cost in public health damages, in lost work days, lost school days, damages to infrastructure through flooding or through droughts, can be tremendous for many countries. I'll just point out Iran here, for which the World Bank estimate of the cost of environmental degradation is 2.8% of GDP. 2.8% of Iranian GDP also happens to be exactly the World Bank's calculation for the cost to Iran of rigorous international sanctions. In countries like India and Pakistan, those costs are, for India, more than 6% of GDP, and for Pakistan, 4% of GDP. India is the world's fastest growing economy today at about 6 or 7% of GDP, and yet at the same time, they are annually facing costs due to water degradation, lack of access to adequate quantities of clean water, equal to that same 6% of GDP. Or for a country of strategic importance to the United States like Afghanistan, the costs of drought on GDP, on levels of household debt, on lost school days can be catastrophic. So these are important challenges and issues not only for the United States, but for our allies, trading partners, competitors. How are we doing so far? What's the situation today? These are levels of water scarcity at a high degree of geographical resolution and on a monthly basis. Many indicators of water stress and water scarcity are calculated on an annual basis or on a national basis. The Falcon Mark indicator of cubic meters of water available per capita per year. This is a finer grained indication of water scarcity. And everywhere that you see that dark red are high levels of water stress on a monthly basis. Hundreds of millions of people around the world live in areas where their annual renewable water availability does not meet the annual renewable water demands. and with pressures like economic growth, population growth, climate change, the call on those water resources, the pressures on the water resources, is rising. The world will see 2.5 billion more mouths to feed by mid-century. Economic growth also raises water demand. Rising GDP can raise water demand as richer populations with more available cash on hand find that they can afford different diets or different products like washing machines, dishwashers, etc. All of which, under current trends, no deus ex machina technological solutions, just the current rate of technological development and the current rate of water demand leads to incredible water deficits in many important basins around the world in between projected supply and projected demand. And these projections are made without accounting for the pressures of climate change, which we'll see rising water stress in those same areas which you saw in the previous map are already significantly stressed. Which leads to, among certain pundits, commentators, students of conflict prevention, conflict management, talk of water wars, or at least the projection of the possibility for countries and communities to face, to come into increasing competition over stressed or scarce water resources, generating studies like these, which attempt to look at changes in rainfall in sub-Saharan Africa, and to project from those the possibilities for increased civil conflict or casualties due to civil conflict. These large quantitative studies overall generate a mixed picture about the relationships in between water availability, climate change, and internal or international conflict. Different statistical methods generate different results. The picture is not yet conclusive. But I think that it's important to go on from those studies, which largely look at changes in the physical availability of water, changes in precipitation, and emphasize that these are not where many water security challenges lie. The causal chains are contextual and complex. This is a map of increasing salinity in the Ganges Brownfield Basin in Bangladesh. And where you see increasing salinity, which is due both to sea level rise, but also reduced flow on the rivers coming downstream, allowing the sea level to seep upstream. This map is showing you increased levels of salinity, and this table is showing you that where the levels of salinity are higher, those are the areas of highest out-migration. People moving to Bangladesh, moving to Dhaka, where they stress infrastructure and resources, and people moving to, what's this country right here?
India.
That's India, right? One mechanism of potential friction conflict that's not related to changes in the physical availability of the resource through precipitation, but to changes generated by the quality of the resource, the salinity making agriculture more difficult, contaminating the waters in those regions. Or militants, insurgents in the Niger Delta, in West Africa, they justify their insurgency, their attacks on oil platforms and the oil industry in the Niger Delta, in part on the continuous contamination and pollution of their water, a water quality security challenge. Or to bring up the case mentioned by Josh, one of the things that you might do if you were concerned about water availability in the future would be to try and increase water storage. Per capita, India and Pakistan have minimal water storage compared to developed countries like the United States. 6,000 cubic meters compared to about 300 for India. Pakistan has water storage for about 1 month of water supply. So you might think, I'll build dams to increase my water storage to buffer against rising demand in the future or increased volatility from climate change. Except in the upstream-downstream relationship of the Indus Basin, Pakistan perceives dams built upstream by India as India putting its thumb on their water jugular. What's going on here? Well, Thucydides tells us that one of the major causes for war is fear of another power. And Pakistan here fears the ability, the perceived ability of India to manipulate, potentially, its water supply. So what's going on is, in effect, the very policies that might be implemented to manage water security, to increase water security, create a water security dilemma in which my water security upstream can be perceived to menace your water security downstream. That it's the management policy and not the physical water itself which creates the security risk. Or to look domestically inside India, the Naxalite insurgents, Communist insurgency in India, one of their rallying cries, land, water, forest are ours. They perceive no access to the decision-making procedures about exploitation of water resources inside the country, the benefits of hydropower building dams. They see those resources as being expropriated from them, not to their benefit. So what's going on there is not inequitable access to the physical resource, it's inequitable access to the decision-making about the use of the physical resource. These are all different water security questions than changes in precipitation affecting agricultural GDP. What can we do about managing these challenges? Well, one thing at the international level, but which also applies domestically, would be agreements, accords, treaties, arrangements to manage shared resources, whether it be between countries or communities. But at the global level, most transboundary basins aren't covered by such treaties. Or as Josh was mentioning, the arrangements exclude key players. The Indus Basin, India and Pakistan have a water treaty, but China and Afghanistan, also riparians, aren't part of it. In the Mekong, China, Myanmar are only observers to the Mekong River Commission. So many basins lack dispute resolution mechanisms, means to grapple with variability in river flows. What can we do to expand those mechanisms to treaties and to regions that don't have them? And this integrated water resources management term of art, covering that effort to manage resources holistically across the basin as a whole, across those sectors, energy, agriculture that I was pointing to before. Who can be against integrated water resources management? Show of hands, who is for fragmented ad hoc water management? But that's not easy to do. Not only because of the lack of institutions, but because, back up to this map here, this is the basin, the Indus River Basin, crosses political boundaries with different institutions for making decisions about water resources, different agriculture ministries, different energy ministries, et cetera, right? But if you want to bring all of the stakeholders together and you're pointing to managing across the basin, well, who's in and who's out? Because this is just the hydrological basin. If I put a map up here of India's electricity grid, you'd see the northern part of the grid sitting here, overlapping partially in, partially outside the basin. State of Punjab in India grows 20% of India's wheat and half of the wheat that's in the national buffer grain supply, which means you've got a food constituency for a water product outside of the basin and outside of the state inside that basin. So when you're integrating food management in the Indus Basin, are the folks who are eating Punjab rice out here, are they in or out? So these institutional challenges are not easy. What else is not easy? Investing sufficiently in the infrastructure to manage water resources. Information management, having the information to make decisions about water resources. These are different climate change models, different runs of different models, projecting climate change impacts on the Ganges Basin. So you're a policymaker deciding, do I build a dam today, which is going to have a lifetime of 50 years, to manage water resources 5 decades hence? Ladies and gentlemen, pick your model. 40 to 50% change positive in precipitation, 50% negative change in precipitation. If you pick this run of this model, you're not going to make the decision that you're going to make if you pick this run of the model. So we need better institutions, better information, and better infrastructure. And I am going to pivot here to supporting, aligning with the recommendations in Josh's paper, which are echoed in a work that my colleague Peter Engelig and I did for the U.S. Water Partnership and the Atlantic Council earlier, asking some of the questions that stand behind Josh's paper. If we accept, as I do, Josh's argument, then how would one go about formulating a U.S. water strategy to address the challenges and the problems that he raises? What ends? And there are a plethora of ends that managing water resources around the world or attempting to assist other countries to manage their resources around the world in the context of U.S. national security, there are a plethora of ends that one could serve. But the tools the United States possesses across the whole of America, across government, civil society, the private sector, faith groups, et cetera, can be grouped into three baskets, I would say, that I've alluded to earlier. Better information, those remote sensing capabilities, those modeling capabilities that Josh mentioned. Support to infrastructure and technologies, and support to institutions. Different countries, different communities will have different needs along those lines. India, to mirror Josh's example of the Indus Basin, significant technical capacities. When I go to India and talk to them about what they think of being their future needs, they say, tell us about the Columbia River Treaty. Tell us about the TVA. How did you do that? We've got engineers. We can build climate models. It's the soft infrastructure of institutions and capacity where we need the assistance. And then the paper to which I'm referring also raises questions about the process for whole of America approach, how to bring in different stakeholders and different participants, and then questions we can take up in the Q&A and that you can imagine about the implementation, how to herd the cats of the U.S. government, and how to coordinate those cats with all the felines that are out there in the rest of the world. Because if we need a whole of America, or to coin a term, a whole of government approach in the United States to facilitate cooperation, better resource governance in the rest of the world, well, how whole of government do they need to be when you're talking about someplace like Yemen or Iraq, with the institutional capabilities and capacities and resources that they have there? How do we put those two together?
Okay. Thank you both to Josh and David for that terrific set of presentations. We've got about 25 minutes now. If you want to, yes, you're already doing it. I will try and call on you in the order you appear. I hope that during the Q&A we are able to potentially get some consensus on where both of you and the room in general feel that the most pressing priorities or the areas where either scarcity or abundance is the greatest concern will coalesce into real risks in, say, the next 5 years, and then maybe the same kind of question beyond. I've been hearing a lot of places where there could be real issues or challenges to U.S. security, international stability, security in general, but I'd like to see if we could try to get some consensus of where we think the biggest problems are going to be in the short term and in the longer term. And then finally, on the issue of where to put or focus our relative effort in terms of next steps and recommendations, there's lots of different things here that are being proposed, but are there some sort of low-hanging fruit, if that's the right term, and B, whether there are some sort of higher return initiatives that we could also focus on, appreciating that we can't do everything everywhere, and therefore, where do we focus our effort? Anyway, I think you were first, so why don't you go ahead? Thank you, Edith.
Thank you. I very much welcome the attention to water. I'm even more concerned with the possible speeding up of the hydrological cycle, which our scientists in Irvine tell us about. Three very brief comments. And the first one is, shouldn't we be focusing on demand? The National Intelligence Council report said that 70% of the use of fresh water was for agriculture, mm-hmm. and over 90% of consumptive use was for agriculture. Mm-hmm. Isn't there a terrific opportunity there to reduce demand by really focusing on more efficient use in agriculture? And that has two additional aspects to it, and I just want your comments on it. One is to address the questions of virtual trade in water, and the second one is to address the trading regime, because after all, in subsidies to water are not included in the agricultural agreement or in the subsidies and countervailing duties. It was actually the U.S. that kept it out of the agricultural agreement. But it really has an enormous implication, especially if you're trying to reduce tariffs, because you're really increasing the problem. And the second is a very brief comment, which is groundwater, as I understand it, accounts for more than 30% of the freshwater resources in rivers. And shouldn't we be paying attention to groundwater, especially when you have non-renewable aquifers in North Africa, in Saudi Arabia, and other countries in the Middle East, and the pollution of that water, which is really a very important problem. I don't know how you feel about that. And the third one is, I saw no reference to the human right to water. And I know that the UNGA passed a resolution, and the UN Human Rights Council resolution was much more sort of nuanced and had a lot of more provisions in it. And isn't there a lot to be done in terms of public-private partnerships and other things if the U.S. is seen as actually trying to implement a human right to water?
Great set of questions. Either you want to take on one or more?
Yeah, I think you've raised a number of important issues, and I wouldn't disagree. I think, you know, obviously agriculture is the main driver of consumption now, and so, you know, opportunities for drip irrigation or other technologies to reduce water wastage in the agricultural sector are central. And I think, you know, groundwater is one of those issues that, I mean, we see it in this country as, you know, California and their droughts of late. That has been something that's kind of on the radar, but people haven't known quite how to deal with. So better scientific awareness of that in other parts of the world. We have a semi-adequate grasp on it here, and I think other countries are even in a far worse position. So I think bringing those issues to light is important. We just have to ensure that they're part of the mix of the conversation. But I totally agree.
No, absolutely. Who was the American bank robber who said, you know, why do you rob banks? Well, that's where the money is. Right? So why would we be trying to increase agricultural water use efficiency? Well, because that's where the water use is. And in this case that we keep turning to, the Indus, irrigation efficiencies in the Indus Basin, which is the most intensively irrigated piece of land in the world, the largest contiguous area of irrigation, irrigation efficiencies are around 30%, which means there's tremendous space there for improvement. Wasteful water use is part of the crisis for groundwater in the Indus Basin as well, where on the Pakistani side of the basin, you're losing about 10 cubic kilometers a year of groundwater. That's equivalent to half of all of the water storage in those limited Pakistani dams that I was referring to earlier. But question, right? Problem, challenge. My wasteful over-irrigation here, that water is seeping into the groundwater. There's about 30-40% overlap between groundwater and surface water in the Indus Basin. So I make my irrigation use more efficient, then I'm changing potentially the water availability through groundwater to somebody else in the same basin. And as we know from the rebound effect of, you know, you get higher gas mileage in your car, what happens? You drive farther. You make the farmers' water use more efficient, they say, oh, hey, now I can grow more. So it's not quite clear that how to approach these efficiency improvements without potential negative knock-on effects affecting, you know, the water use or availability to my neighbor, how will that impact my, you know, water use for, you know, production of my crops, what economic calculations am I making. In the United States, one of the most advanced agricultural economies in the world, USDA surveys of farmers find that about half of them don't use the most advanced irrigation technology because economically, for example, it doesn't make sense for the crop that they're growing, or there are other impediments to knowing about or applying those technologies. So, you know, one area, both in the United States and abroad, for better water management is agricultural extension services. not just the application, but the awareness of the possibility of the application. But again, have to watch out for robbing Peter to pay Paul and the implications for other users of changes in use patterns, efficiency patterns. But certainly that's where to look, because that's where the that's where the waste is in my part.
Okay, Ruth, you next, and then Ellen.
I can't move that, so I'm not even going to try.
We can hear you.
You know, for those of us who have worked in this area, it's hard, if not impossible, to argue with this, including what Edie said. But and it's an important technical discussion. But and in normal times, a paper like this would be kind of a call to arms.
Right.
But these aren't normal times, and I'm curious if you've thought a little bit about audience and how one would go about, presenting these issues these days, and to whom and in what form, and to have some impact, because I don't think there's much disagreement in the room about the importance of this, and just on a anecdotal level within the United States too. I mean, during the height of the California drought, I remember driving through the agricultural areas of California and seeing spray irrigation all over the place. So I mean, it's a big problem, but how do you get from all these great recommendations, perfectly logical, perfectly right, to action, especially given, some of the challenges we're seeing today?
Yeah, I think that's a really important concern. I mean, one issue is, water may have a different resonance than climate, right? So talking about climate change may now, even more than it once was, be problematic as a hitching the water wagon to climate change agenda may be a hard sell. But, I think there is a strong bipartisan support for the water and sanitation issue already. Now, can we build on that, and start, start in Congress, but also start with potentially sympathetic folks in the administration, wherever they may be, and say, like, this just makes sense for us to be concerned about this. The thing that I'm concerned about, speaking to Paul's question about, exigencies, I had a conversation with somebody who says, looks like NASA's budget on earth sciences, $2.2 billion. Yeah, they're pretty much teeing up to cut that entirely this year. And so we can do space exploration. Does that mean somebody else picks that up? I mean, I just think that could be, let's stop that if we can. But also, focus the conversation on where we have shared ground, which is, water's essential for life. We have strong bipartisan support for extending taps and toilets. Countries need to be able to manage their water effectively to be able to meet that agenda that we all support. But they can't do it unless there's a wider institutional apparatus around that. Let's provide some resources for that.
Ellen?
So just in terms of Josh's policy recommendations at the end, it had a little bit of a flavor of, we've got this cohesive community that all cares about this, and why aren't we getting more attention? And whether, and I think you're hearing this from several of the other comments, maybe the plan B is to accept that you can work on the water dimension of other issues. So take the water piece of agriculture or economic development or something and make your inroads there, but don't necessarily expect success on having water as a standalone new special interest. So whether you ride the banner of food security or economic development, I mean, those are just, they're a little bit tactics, and they're a little bit how to repackage the things that you are most concerned about. But my question was about the durability of river basin treaties.
Right.
You, I know, have worked on the Nile as well as the Indus. This gentleman here has written on Israeli-Jordanian cooperation over the Jordan, which has turned out to be more agile, I think. Nile, my understanding, David, was that the countries know they have to renegotiate the treaty, but it's a zero sum for them. I mean, it's hard for them to get past that, the reallocation based on changed demographics, et cetera. How do you see the durability of the River Basin agreements. I don't think the U.S. should attempt to reinvent the wheel. It's a little bit work with what exists and try to make it better. So do you see that as a promising area for American diplomacy, or should we leave it to the regional parties themselves?
Take that.
Well, working in reverse order, then, as was illustrated by that grid of the different management capacities offered by the different treaty institutions, the simple answer is that some of them are going to be more robust and resilient than others, and not entirely dependent on the language of the treaty. Israel and Palestine, India and Pakistan, they're not Switzerland and France looking at the Rome. They're not the United States and Canada looking at Colombia. So, for example, in the Indus Treaty, Article 7, there in black and white, cooperation. Build infrastructure cooperatively. Article 6, we can share data and even come up with new means of sharing data. But how out of date is that treaty relative to current pressures, capabilities to address climate change? Well, the language on that data sharing says, for example, oh, and if one party wants information sent by to the other party by wire, then the demanding party will pay for it. Right, the use of remote sensing and other data sources. So the question is, are the institutions robust to the new challenges? And in some cases, the language offers capacities, but only if the parties will use it, trust each other to use it, and, you know, hence the reference to, you know, Columbia and the Columbia River and United States and Canada. We trust each other. More or less, right, Aaron? although more than, you know, other parties do. So can they take advantage of what capacities there are? And where there aren't capacities, can they trust each other or negotiate to add those capacities? And so if a case like the Nile or the Indus, a question that has to come up if we talk about making additions to those institutions or renegotiating those institutions is, are we just opening a can of worms? Because if we say, well, this part here is inadequate to meet my needs, so could we talk about it, then the other party is likely to say, hey, you know what, there's this other text, there's this other part of the agreement which doesn't meet our needs, and there's a risk in the minds, not only of outside diplomats, but also the parties themselves, that, you know, it could unravel. But that being said, the institutions that we have in many cases are not adequate, robust to the emerging challenges, and the knowledge on the part of the parties that they aren't can be one lever to wedge open a conversation to say, hey, you know, climate change isn't your fault or my fault. It's a pressure that's out there. So rather than blaming each other, are there ways that we could cooperate?
I think I'm kind of curious, just to follow up on Ellen's point about whether, you know, are these bilateral, multilateral, transboundary agreements, are there places that require our kind of, I don't want to use intervention, but at least some kind of pressure for them to make some of the trade-offs? Or do we let them kind of try to work it out ourselves? And is there a sort of an independent mediator, if you will, that we can turn to, as that we can indirectly? So I'm looking for...
Yeah, the answer there is, I think, case by case as well. I mean, the United States, continental land mass, continental geography, continental climatology. We've got experience with arid agriculture because groundwater law is different in the East and the West. Every configuration that you can think of water management has been tried in the U.S. and succeeded somewhere and failed somewhere as well. We've got lots of experience to offer. And because of the variety of our experience, it doesn't always have to be, hey, we know best. Here's the best practices and lessons learned. You guys go to it. We can talk about shared issues. Hey, we've all got to confront water management under climate change. We've all got to confront drought. You know, how do we do it? We have lots of experience institutionally to offer, and there may be cases where Nixon can go to China, and there may be cases where the last thing you want is the U.S. you know, sticking its finger in there. But through, for example, you know, information, we can perhaps cultivate and facilitate certain discussions. And it doesn't necessarily have to be through governments either. Right. Because of this incredible, you know, for example, availability of information, civil society groups within these countries can say, hey, you know, water resources management and water use is a big national secret, according to you, capital city. But on Google right here, I can see. You know, it's kind of like Spot in the old Soviet Union maps where the railway stations and the intersections weren't in the right place. Well, that doesn't matter anymore because there are other sources of information that still need to be ground-truthed and calibrated. The remote sensing doesn't replace all measurements, but there's just that possibility.
Okay, I think Scott was next, and then John. We don't have an awful lot of time, so please keep your questions fairly short.
Sure, just a kind of quick issue to raise. I mean, I think, one reason this is such a difficult problem is that, inherently the kind of biggest water problems are those that, the U.S. isn't essentially either can't or shouldn't solve. At least themselves. I think you do need the kind of picking up some of these points. You do need the kind of multilateral picture. You need a kind of broader stakeholder picture. And I guess, what I'm kind of wrestling with here is, admittedly, this is, again, a very difficult thing to do. But, I think part of it needs to be the U.S. playing some role in terms of trying to shape this kind of crazy quilt international water governance picture that we have, and the many competing and sort of bodies, agendas, et cetera, that exist at that level. I think it's really a problem that water is kind of it's very attractive. Everybody wants to be involved in the space, but everybody also wants to have their own show to run, and the result is that we have this kind of crazy quilt, and there's not a lot of good kind of strategy for how it all fits together.
John?
Daniel, I think you were first.
But please, go ahead.
Okay, I'll be very brief. All right, thank you. Josh, congratulations. Great piece, and I certainly highly support the recommendations there. I'm actually going to quote Ellen, if I might, from something you said about 5 years ago. You pointed out at some event a really important distinction between the aggregated judgments that we come across in a room like this versus the disaggregated reality of the real world. Did I get that about right?
Yeah, it was at the Wilson Center, yeah.
Yeah, perfect. And that phrase is
that there's a macro story, but there's lots of micro stories that don't fit into the macro story.
That's right. And so this follows on a lot of what we're hearing from all three of you. How do we, I'm thinking of this October 1st, 2017 deadline. The Trump administration needs to produce this global water strategy to Capitol Hill by that point. What should we, around this table, inside and outside of government, bolstered by the USWPPs, bolstered by, Josh, your piece here, what should we do to make sure that the recommendations, the global water strategy, the path forward there, actually properly is demand responsive, let me put it that way, to the disaggregated realities of the real world out there. Seems like we ought to be, we're all friends here. And that's the problem. We're all friends here. Mm-hmm. We all get it. Every single person is nodding their head vigorously. But I want to be sure that what's in that strategy is actually responsive to that real world. And we welcome your guidance offline or on about that.
Josh, you want to take a crack at that?
Yeah, I mean, I've often thought there has to be a kind of consensus ask from the community of concern that settles on something that they think is achievable. You think about like the piece that Ruth and Sherry Goodman published recently, that the recommendations that were in that were similar to the ones that I, independently came up with. They're pretty similar to the ones that David and Peter came up with. So I think we're kind of gravitating towards a kind of set of asks. But, to the point that was raised earlier, are we in a different world now in terms of what's realistic and achievable? So, maybe the thought of a standalone kind of large-scale water initiative, Feed the Future Light or something might have been possible 6 months ago, but may not be doable now. So what is our plan B? And I think we're all trying to figure out what that might be. Is it hitch this agenda to some other set of issues that are live? I don't think we really know yet. But then there's some defense to be played on things that are important, which are science capabilities of just even having an appreciation of all the challenges that are out there. And if that goes away, it's going to be harder to say, the United States has these assets to offer to you in other countries. Oh, we had them, but we got rid of them, you know. So I think there's sort of short-run firefighting, and then there's building the wider constituency to do something of Plan B, whatever that is. There just needs to be more conversations on a consistent basis about, okay, now what?
Quickly, our third author is right here.
Yeah, apologies.
Okay, I'm going to put Aaron on the spot here, Aaron, and maybe this part is off the record, but tell us what you think would be the one, two, three things, if you could wave your magic wand, we should do here, and particularly in relation to John's question.
No, I appreciate it, but I'm not sure I'm in a position to be able to answer that question right now.
You're not. Okay. All right, we'll go to your...
What I can say, of course, is that we're taking the strategy very seriously. We've got a pretty robust process where we're sitting down with the agencies to talk through what it is that we can do and how we can do it, how we can take some of these capabilities and deploy them more readily to places where we think that there are significant risks. How do we articulate those risks, and what kind of risks are we trying to deal with, and how do we mobilize these resources around them is still yet to be seen within the forthcoming architecture.
Is that a function of what you're hearing from the White House, or is your reluctance based on what you think your guidance will be from the White House? Is that the issue here? Or?
Well, I think we're still waiting to see. I mean, we're going through a transition process, and so we're still waiting to see what the priorities and how the new administration wants to carry out some of the work that we're looking at.
Okay. I think David and you, sir, are next, and then we should probably wrap things up.
It's on.
Yes. Thank you. I wanted to bring up a topic which I don't think has yet been discussed during the session, which is water pricing and water trading. You sort of talk in the report and in David's remarks, you also kind of mention the role of the private sector and whether it's in public-private partnerships or et cetera. At the risk of sounding like a cold-blooded economist, nothing helps incentivize behavior like the bottom line in these companies. But obviously, we are right now confronted with a patchwork of very different systems and structures on pricing water. Obviously, in many municipal areas, water isn't priced at all. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to get the speaker's thoughts on that and see what are the kind of challenges. First, sort of how important is to align the economic incentives behind water conservation and water efficiency, et cetera. How important is that? And what are the sort of major challenges that are confronting that? Is it purely kind of political and optical, or is it administrative? Like, sort of what are the kind of areas that we can move forward?
And
thank you.
Just take the last question, and you can respond to both.
So great discussion and presentations. I agree with the recommendations. I wanted to point out very disturbing trend that's happening in some of the real flashpoint transboundary basins, which is the securitization of water information.
Mm-hmm.
It's creating a downward spiral in relations when you want an upward spiral. Right. And we actually have some experience with how to deal with that and to countervail it, drawing on Peter Haas's concept of epistemic communities and the Mediterranean Action Plan. And it's something that the United States and the developed world more generally can be very, can have a lot of promising intervention, positive intervention to help try to build these communities. At a more grassroots level, instead of talking about big expensive remote sensing projects, talk about crowd sensing projects, which in many of these countries can break the securitization of water. And then finally, I think in terms of our domestic situation, we need to figure out a way to incentivize collective action in areas where people have shared interests. And we have a situation where it isn't well understood who's interested in which basin, where, and why. And if we can make that more transparent, the opportunities for people to find each other and pool their resources independent of government sponsorship, I think, could be very potent.
point.
So on this pricing issue, my reaction, World Bank had a really important paper that came out last year on this, and it was kind of reflecting on the need to price better. But there's also the experience that the bank had in pushing a kind of privatization agenda in the kind of 90s and 2000s, for which there was quite a lot of pushback in a number of places, in which people who lacked access to water also felt like this was leading to even less access than before. So I think there's a need to kind of have a kind of new strategy of figuring out how do you price it in a way that guarantees access for the world's most vulnerable. And I'm not sure if we settled on sort of technological or pricing arrangements that gets at that right. The political barriers in lots of different places are very powerful. So I think that's an important conversation. I'm not sure maybe the wider water management community has ideas on that, and we'd be happy to talk about them more. But to the second issue about the convening power of the United States and being able to bring partners together who need to talk and build kind of epistemic communities, I think in this gets to the challenge of figuring out where are the right places and the highest priorities and what can we do. I mean, at that level, it gets kind of basin specific because you might think, well, in this place, there's a high need for it, but the U.S. may not be the best interlocutor, so maybe we need a multilateral partner. But that should all be part of the strategy and say where are our talents put to best use. And it's hard from afar outside the USG to get a feel for that. You have some intuitions. But for example, my collaborator Paula Newberg at the University of Texas has worked in Pakistan for a long time and worked in the wider region, but it's hard for those folks in Pakistan and India and Bangladesh to have a conversation. So she, along with folks at Georgetown over the winter break, hosted people in Doha along with other partners. It wasn't a USG initiative directly. There was some USG money, but there was some private money. There was Georgetown money. That's the kind of thing that we could do that may be hard to do, but it's the kind of thing that has to be done so that those folks can learn lessons from each other, because they're all facing kind of similar physical problems. Some of it's transborder, but some of it isn't, but they don't have ready opportunities to have a conversation. And so having that in the mix of things that we do on a regular basis, it may help them do some individual and collective problem solving that wouldn't have happened were it not for our support.
David, you want to final word?
Sure. Just to take a different tack on a few of the points that have come up on the securitization of water information is certainly a danger, and is a danger of the type of conversation that we're having here, talking about the links potential between political conflicts or tensions over water resources, because one potential reaction is to, oh, now I have to be careful, hoard my water resources, et cetera. And the informational securitization is a tremendous problem in some of these hotspot basins, like the Indus, where, for example, a couple of years ago, one of the deans of Indian water policy was sitting at a conference like this one and described having put together for the Indian government a volume of maps and information about water resources availability and management. And then when those volumes were actually produced by the government, he requested a copy and was told he couldn't have one because it was a state secret. And he said, I wrote that. But to turn to the economic incentives and the pricing of water, or the pricing of water information and the increasing availability of the private sector to supply information, there's an exclusivity risk there as well of consumers being priced out of accessing that information. If the governments aren't going to fund those satellites, for example, or aren't going to fund the crowdsourcing, passing out cell phones to everybody in Bangladesh so they can take pictures of river water levels, then consumers, users may not have access to that information. And another anecdote from a Track 2 dialogue of Indians and Pakistanis. We're sitting around a table where natural scientists, social scientists, policy analysts, and policy practitioners are talking about different studies that they've done for their governments, for their universities. And I thought, as Josh was saying, there are not a lot of opportunities sometimes for these parties to meet with each other and talk. So I thought I would hear a lot of the Pakistani scientists saying, I wrote this study, and the Indian responding, oh, could I see that? I don't know where that is. I didn't know that was available. And that did happen. But you know what else happened? The Pakistani colleague sitting next to the author said, I didn't know you did that. Where is that? So there's an information management challenge, and availability and pricing is even part of this, because I, on my laptop, could send an email back to an intern sitting in Washington and say, hey, can you get on JSTOR and send me a PDF of that article? Mm. But the guy or the gal in Pakistani University who doesn't have access to that JSTOR database can't see it. Right, so we've got information exchange, sharing, and management problem that is exacerbated by securitization concerns, but also about intellectual property concerns. And final tack on economic incentives, yes, bottom line matters. One macro level aspect of that potential economization of water would be to go back to that virtual water trade question, right? Israel was supposed to run out of water decades ago. How did they manage? Well, they decided to stop growing some water-intensive crops. They are past masters of technological innovations. But if you're going to do that, if you're going to engage in virtual water trade, you have to be willing to submit your water security and your food security to trade, right? To, depending upon global markets or your neighbors for your food, for example. So if we were talking about the Tigris-Euphrates and we were the Ottoman Empire, we would say, as the Turks do, hey, it makes perfect sense to put the irrigation schemes and the hydropower schemes up here in Turkey, because this is where the mountains are. This is where the vertical drop is that makes sense for generating hydropower. You don't want to put a dam way down there and air it a rock, because you lose all that water to evaporation. That makes no sense. If we were running this under an integrated water management system for the basin as a whole, taking account of all the stakeholders and engaging in virtual water trade, hey, we'll grow the food up here, generate the hydropower up here, and we'll sell you the food downstream and buy your oil. Makes impeccable sense, except if you were the Iraqis and the Syrians, if there ever are again Syrians, telling them, oh, you're going to depend for your food security on imports from Turkey. Are you willing to do that? Or are you willing to submit yourself to the potential volatility of global food markets, as we saw in the food crises 2007-2008? Politically versus economically, it's a challenge.
Okay, we've gone over the limit, I'm sorry, and we could clearly go on much longer here. I feel like we've really just started the conversation, to be honest. Maybe we can convene a longer meeting in the future on this, because it ain't going away. So I do want to thank you both, Josh and David, for excellent presentations. And again, thank you all for being here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, I